16 hours. Hey, a show about barbecue coming up next. So 16 hours for this? Hi, I'm Alan Smith. Welcome to Garden to Table. I'm in Kansas City, Missouri, home to beautiful fountains, parks, architecture, and some legendary barbecue, and that's what we're focusing on in today's show. Now, if you want great barbecue, you have to follow the pig. And what I mean by that is, all the best recipes are just recipes without the best cuts of meat. But of course, to get the best cuts, you have to go right to the source, and that's what we're going to explore today. I'm also going to share some healthy and delicious recipes that are perfect for your next barbecue. You know, it's hard to say just when and how barbecue came about. I mean, let's face it, we've been cooking meat over an open fire for a long time. I mean, like caveman days. Now in the South, pork has been a staple, well, since the Revolutionary War and before. You see, pigs were a convenient food source for Southerners because there were so many of them, and they were easy to raise and care for. The slaughtering of hogs became an annual family, if not a community event. Some barbecue historians believe that Southern barbecue grew from these community-involved gatherings. If you ever Googled barbecue, you'll find that Arthur Bryant's barbecue in Kansas City comes near the top, if not the top, every time. Hey, celebrities and presidents have been coming to this place for decades, and I know why. It is so delicious. So why don't we head back to the kitchen and see if we can't learn a few of their trade secrets. Willis, it's just a beehive of activity here.
Oh yes, just another day at Arthur Bryant's.
Is it really? So this is where it all happens. This is the pit.
Yes, sir. This is the pit here. Primarily hickory and oak, and that's what we cook with.
I don't want to get into the family recipes here too much, but one of the keys with this is, I guess, cooking it for a long time and at a low heat.
Yes, sir. We cook it about 12 hours, between 225, 250 degrees.
Really, 12 hours?
About 12 hours, yes, sir. The brisket. The next step is the cooking process.
Oh, great. Uh-huh. So this is where it happens. Oh, you got a big rack up there.
Oh, yes. This is a slab. We cook the ribs anywhere from 4 to 5 hours.
4 to 5 hours. Yes, wow, look at that. That's beautiful.
This is a pork shoulder.
Oh, look at that.
Cook it about 12 hours. Okay, this is called a barbecue roll.
All right, the barbecue roll. Look at that. It sure is. All right, now with all this out, I mean, at this point, you're ready to serve the customers, right?
Yes, sir.
There you go. You're going to love it. Try the original sauce. It's my favorite. Hey, you can have the greatest recipe for barbecue in the whole wide world, but if you don't have the best selection of meat, well, you don't have much. So why don't we follow the pig to the local butcher shop? Alex, you've certainly taken a unique approach to the local butcher concept.
What we've really tried to do is bring the local back into the local butcher. So it's not just a man that you know who's cutting meat, it's also a place where you know that all the meat is local.
It's about the sourcing.
It's about the sourcing. It comes from, you know, about 100 miles from here. And we can tell you where this pig came from, when it was raised, what breed it was, and
right,
just everything you'd want to know.
And you may have even been to the farm yourself.
I have been to all these farms,
all
yes.
Right.
Make
Very
farm
good.
Visits before we buy anything from people.
Excellent.
This is a pork shoulder, AKA the Boston butt.
Uh-huh.
And what Adam's doing right now is we're just gonna take the bone out so you can kind of see where everything comes from. This is the classic pulled pork cut.
So, I see.
So all the pulled pork you see in all the restaurants in Kansas City, it's all bone-in Boston butts. So what you're really gonna do when you're barbecuing this is just take this thing whole and give it a long, slow cook, and you're gonna pull the meat into shreds and then sauce it. And when we say sauce it in Kansas City, that means we're applying our sauce and letting it soak it up. What we do that's a little different is we get some heritage breed pigs. This is a Chester White. What they bring to the table that the commodity pork doesn't is a couple things. Namely, this bad boy right here, which is fat. Commodity pigs these days have been bred to be incredibly lean.
He was selected on breed certification information. With these, there must be less than 1 6/10 inches of back fat.
I think they were wrong. I like the fat. And a lot of our customers do too. There's a lot of flavor in the fat, and it's really important to have that fat and that flavor in there. So also, if you notice the color, it's got a lot deeper, richer red color.
Right. It's not as pale.
It's not the other white meat.
Right, right. It's very much a red meat.
It's definitely a red meat. All right, so we're moving on, and these are our baby back ribs.
The ribs, yeah.
Yep. So if you look at these things, these are actually coming from a whole bone-in pork loin. And this would be the ribeye if we were looking at a cow. So Ben's cutting off the bones off the back.
So this is where the rib is connected to the chop itself.
Absolutely. Right. So the bone on a bone-in pork chop is actually a baby back rib. You know, it's a little bit leaner than the spare ribs. Spare ribs are going to sit anatomically right about here. They've got more belly in them. This has more loin.
Fatter, right.
Yep. So these are our pork ribeyes, aka a bone-in pork chop.
And Ben's cutting right to the very center between rib to rib.
Rib to rib. Yep. So we cut single bone. A double bone takes a long time to cook.
Well, I was going to say, and it takes a while to eat too.
Yeah,
that's a very generous portion.
Yes, they're usually about 12 ounce cuts. So it's a big steak. So Miles is cutting spare ribs. These sit just like this.
Ah, right.
And what we do is cut these into two separate racks.
Here's that belly you're talking about that gives it more meat.
Yep. Right. And so we're going to trim these up a little St. Louis style, which involves taking this first this skirt off. So this is the skirt steak.
Okay.
This is what we call a skirt steak if we're looking at a cow.
Okay. Right.
Pork skirts are pretty small, so they're not something we normally go for.
Would that end up in sausage or something?
Yes. Okay. Great in sausage.
Yeah.
So we're going to cut the tip of the ribs off. If you see just how you get the little white bones right there, pork bones tend to soften as they get a little bit closer to the end. So we're going to trim this off. And what we're going for here is a uniform size. So when we're doing a competition barbecue like Kansas City is famous for, we want very consistent uniform ribs. So we're going to cut these all so that they're the same size. And that's what's important. So they all cook at the same rate.
Where did this whole idea of Kansas City barbecue come from? What's the history or legacy there?
Well, it's really an interesting story. You know, 100 years ago or so, we were the connection point for the West to bring all of their meat. We would feed out and slaughter a lot of animals here, which means a lot of the employees, or so the story goes, got to take home the lesser cuts. So the briskets, the fatty briskets.
I see.
And they got creative. The best way to do it was to cook it a long time, and everybody likes smoke, so it all kind of came together.
This is certainly a great way to understand where your food comes from, but we're going to take this one step further. In fact, we're going to follow the pig back to the farm, an all-natural farm where this process actually begins. Tom, these are looking really nice.
They're finishing out. That bigger one there will probably be ready in a couple weeks, and these smaller ones will be just a couple weeks behind.
I see.
There's 8 of them left in here for this summer, and these are just poplar sprouts, but they usually like anything green that we throw in there.
Yeah, I bet they're always happy to see you coming with either something out of the garden or even table scraps.
Yeah, they're not real picky. They'll eat just about anything anytime we bring them something different.
Yeah.
Tomato plants out of the garden, sweet corn plants, they love it.
Yeah, anything you might not use anymore, they'll put to good use.
Yeah.
Well, let's just talk about nutrition for a moment. What is their standard diet? What is it typically made of?
They've got access full-time to a feeder that's got corn, soybean meal, and then vitamins and minerals added in it.
The approach you're taking here is there's no antibiotics in this, or there's no animal products or byproducts in their feed.
Strictly a vegetarian-based feed. A lot of times there would be a pesticide, a wormer in their feed, but we just don't see a need for that.
Mm-hmm.
If they're outdoors with a little room to move around, you know, we never have to doctor a sick one.
That's great.
If they're not sick, they don't need drugs.
Well, and also the fact that they're not confined. I mean, you've got them in a lot here where they can be in the shade, they can be pigs, they can wallow around in the mud, which looks like these are having a good time doing.
Yeah, they're appreciating the rain last weekend too. But yeah, they'll root around in the dirt. they'll dig up grubs and tree roots and worms, and there's got to be some nutritional value to some of that. I don't know how much, but it sure makes them happy.
And they certainly have plenty of room here to romp and play and do whatever they want. They look very happy.
They seem to be.
As they say, happy as a hog in slop.
That's it.
Well, Tom, there certainly seems to be greater interest in where food comes from the general public. They like to know what breeds of animals they are, how they're raised, where they come from, even the families that raise them.
Yeah, there's good demand the last several years. A lot of people ask about the breeds. There are good ones of every breed. The main thing we look for is it has to be a hog that's raised outdoors, you know, generations back, because some animals are just not bred to survive, you know, outdoors in nature. The breed is not so much important as the way that breed has been run in the past.
I see. Of course, just being a family farm, I mean, you've got all these girls and Paul to help you. I bet your kids don't have any problem knowing where their food comes from like some kids do.
No, there's not usually any doubt around here.
Well, I bet they're good help, too.
Well, they are. They do a lot of the chores. If I have to be busy doing something, gone for a day, they can take care of the place.
That's wonderful. You're doing a great job here. Keep up the good work.
Well, appreciate it.
Yeah. Hey, my sister just got some heritage pigs, Berkshires. They're really cute. She loves them. My brother-in-law is very practical. These are going to be breeders, but the offspring, well, they'll be butchered. I don't know how my sister's going to feel about that.
I'm Rich Wright, and this is Buttercup Meadow Farms, and we got here are a couple of Berkshire pigs. This is a breeding pair. This guy right here is a boar. That means he's an intact male. He hasn't been castrated, so he can have babies. This girl right here is a gilt. That means she's a girl that hasn't had a litter yet. And then you can have a bred gilt, which we hope to have for her bred with him in a few more months, probably around February. We're in October right now, so she has a few more months until she'll be ready to breed. Once she has her litter, then she'll become a sow. So she's about 3 months old right now, and he's a couple weeks younger than she is. Her line comes from really good mothering characteristics, a lot of live births, a lot of production in the litter. We expect great things out of her. And then I picked him because of his structure. He's got a nice long back. That means his offspring should have really good loins, and he's got a real nice structure to him. He's a fast grower because his daddy was a big guy. So between the two of them, we should have good mothering and a real fast growing pig. These are going to be our foundation pigs, so they'll probably get 300 pounds, 400 pounds, because we'll keep them. But they're babies, they're going to be market hogs, so we'll probably they'll get to be around 240 pounds before we take them off to the market. Well, these two pigs will probably try to get about 4 or 5 litters out of these. They normally can get about 2 litters per year. They're an omnivore, so they'll eat just about anything. They're kind of like us. They'll eat our scrap food. We're in a what I call the nursery pen. Until these guys get a little bit bigger, they'll go out into a pasture. And then they'll start eating our grasses, and then they'll also get a little bit of grains as well. And then we've got a lot of pecans in one of our pastures, so what they'll finish off on is eating a lot of those pecans, so that meat should have a real good nutty taste and a good nutty flavor.
Of course, the classic and perfect side dish to barbecue is potato salad. And when you create a potato salad with fresh ingredients like this one and use lots of basil, it's really outstanding. You see, basil is typically relegated to the herb garden, but I believe it should be used throughout the garden and in containers as well. You might be surprised to know that there are many types of basil. There's dwarf Greek basil, and I love this one called spicy globe. These are excellent choices for bordering raised beds or for growing in containers. Their leaves are small, which makes them perfect for bite-sized appetizers. Then there's lettuce leaf basil on the other end of the spectrum. They have really large leaves, hence the name lettuce leaf. The large leaves are a peppery flavor with a hint of mint and clove, perfect for tomato sandwiches, for instance. And then, of course, there's sweet basil. It's so easy to grow, and I can't get enough of this stuff. That's what we used in this recipe. Now, even though there are lots of different kinds of basils out there to choose from, they all have similar growing conditions. They love a sunny location. They like consistent moisture, but well-drained soils. If you're just beginning in the gardening world and starting out, you might just want to start with basil because it really is so easy. Now, let's get to that recipe because I think you're going to want to try this. To kick this recipe off, you'll need 1 pound of red potatoes cleaned and cut into bite-sized chunks, plus 5 ears of corn cleaned and shucked. In separate pots, boil the potatoes until they're tender. That'll be about 10 to 15 minutes. You see, you don't want them to be too soft. And then boil the corn for about 5 to 7 minutes until the kernels are tender. While the potatoes and corn are cooking, take 1 pint of grape tomatoes and cut those in half, and thinly slice 1 small red onion. When the potatoes and corn are ready, drain the water and submerge them in an ice bath to stop them from cooking any further. Okay, now after the potatoes and corn have cooled, drain them, cut the kernels of corn off of each ear. Now be sure to hold the corn upright with a dish towel so your hand doesn't slip. And just add those kernels to a bowl with the potatoes. Next, add in the tomatoes, the onion, and now it's time for the basil. What I use is sweet basil, and I used about 10 to 12 leaves, coarsely chopped. Add those to the blend, and then finish it off by drizzling 1/4 cup of extra virgin olive oil and the juice from 2 lemons. Then just sprinkle 2 teaspoons of an all-purpose Greek seasoning. Toss gently to combine and then serve immediately. Look at this, isn't it beautiful? It smells so good. You see, this recipe will make 6 generous servings. Now think about this. If you go to the grocery store and you buy the potatoes and the corn, and you buy the basil and you buy the onions, you're looking at about $1.90 to 95 cents per serving. If you grow your own basil, you're talking about $1.15 a serving. So think about that. Give this recipe a try. You'll love it with your barbecue. Okay, now you've learned a lot about the meat, where it comes from, how it's made, how you cook it, which is the most important part of the barbecue. We're gonna talk a little bit about the sauces now. And the sauces we're gonna be talking about come from this area called the Barbecue Belt, which is definitely in the South. It runs from the Carolinas all the way over to Arkansas, a little bit into Oklahoma and Texas, but not too far into there. Sauce is extremely important in the South. There are signature sauces. Every state sort of has its own flavor. And so we're gonna start off with a basic barbecue sauce here from the Carolinas. You'll find this in Eastern Carolina, both North and South. It's just pepper and vinegar with a little bit of salt and a little bit of sugar. Got a couple of different peppers in there. You can see kind of the red pepper flakes floating around and just some coarse ground pepper as well, black pepper. All right, now this is what many people consider to be sort of the original barbecue sauce. All barbecue sauce is vinegar-based. Here we have some apple cider vinegar, which is very popular, especially in the lower southern states and in South Carolina. North Carolina, you're gonna get more of just a plain white distilled vinegar. As you move to the west in Carolina, you get what's known as a Lexington dip. And it's essentially the same thing. It's got pepper in it, it's got some vinegar, it's got salt, some sugar, but they also made a couple of changes to it. One, they tend to use brown sugar when they make this sauce instead of just white sugar. And it also has a little bit more hot sauce in it, and they add some ketchup. And so tomatoes are finally being introduced into it with the ketchup. It's not too much here. You can see it's not super red, but as we start moving south, we're gonna start adding more and more tomatoes and more ketchup. That's what this sauce is here. This is a sort of Western South Carolina sauce. As you can see, it's much thicker than what we've had so far. It's very sweet. It also has dark brown sugar in it.
Lots of tomatoes, lots of ketchup. There's a little bit of onion in this. As you can see, it's a lot thicker than the other two sauces we've been dealing with so far. It's a little stickier, it's a lot sweeter. As I mentioned, these use brown sugar. This one uses a dark brown sugar. This uses light brown sugar as opposed to just plain white sugar. All brown sugar is white sugar that's been mixed with molasses. And the more molasses you use, the darker the sugar gets. So these are your basic sauces. So from this point, as we move across what we call the barbecue belt, we're just gonna get variations of these sauces. So for instance, in South Carolina, over on the east side, you get what's called mustard-based sauce. Really yellow, we got some mustard in there. It's still peppers, it's still sugar, it's still vinegar, it's all that, but instead of ketchup, we've got mustard, we get this nice, bright yellow sauce. And in Tennessee, what they're gonna do is they're gonna completely get rid of using sugar at all and just go for straight molasses. They're also gonna add, what else? Tennessee whiskey, and they use it primarily for ribs. Going back down south again, we get a Mississippi mop sauce. It's also a mustard base, but it also has some ketchup in it. They change the vinegar again. They tend to use a rice vinegar in the Delta sauces down there, as well as over in Arkansas. Gives it a little bit of a sweeter flavor than just your plain white distilled vinegar. Now, by far the strangest looking sauce that we have, this is a sauce invented by Big Bob Gibson in Decatur, Alabama. It's called Alabama White Sauce, and it looks almost like a ranch dressing. It is a mayonnaise-based sauce. It doesn't use ketchup, doesn't use mustard, puts mayonnaise and horseradish in there, still with the vinegar, still with the peppers and the other spices and hot sauce. It's a really tasty sauce. It's kind of tangy, so I recommend you try it on chicken sometime. But remember, as the saying goes in the barbecue belt, if it ain't pork, it ain't barbecue. All right, and our last sauce here, rounding out our barbecue belt, comes from Georgia. It's once again a tomato-based sauce, very thick as you can see. But what makes it a little bit different, we put some peaches in there to give it a really, really sweet flavor. So that's some Georgia peach sauce for you. Still peppers, still vinegar, still all the basic ingredients. But once again, giving it a little regional flavor by throwing in something you can't get just anywhere. Hope you've enjoyed this tour of the sauces of the South. I'm gonna have me some barbecue.
You know, no barbecue joint worth its salt is going to give away its secrets, like how it roasts its meats and prepares them, or particularly its sauces. You see, it's the sauce so often that sets them apart. It makes them distinct and interesting. Well, I did have an opportunity to meet someone who was willing to spill the beans on their family recipe, as long as I kept it quiet and only shared it with my friends. You're going to love it.
This is my family's secret recipe for barbecue sauce, and it's really easy to make. The easiest way to get started is to have the ingredients ready to go. This eliminates the chance of you burning it. You'll need 1 cup of onion chopped, 2 garlic cloves minced, and 5 Roma tomatoes peeled and chopped. Now, the easiest way to peel and chop the tomatoes is to cut off the end where it's been picked from the vine, cut side down. With a sharp knife, gently run down the side of the tomato, peeling the skin away. Now you're ready to make the sauce. Start by melting 2 tablespoons of butter in a medium saucepan. Then add the onion and garlic and saute until tender. Next, stir in the tomatoes, 2 tablespoons of Worcestershire sauce, 3 tablespoons of red wine vinegar, 1 teaspoon of chili powder, 1 teaspoon of dried mustard, and 2 teaspoons of salt. Bring this mixture to a boil, then reduce the heat and simmer the sauce. Uncover it for 20 minutes, stirring occasionally. The last step is to stir in 1/2 cup of molasses and simmer. Uncover it an additional 10 minutes. I also add in a little black pepper. You notice the sauce is a little chunky. You can leave it like this or puree it in a food processor. Pureeing it makes it a little thicker, especially after it's been refrigerated. I like to use the unpureed sauce in my baked beans. This recipe makes one pint, but it can easily be doubled or even tripled. And it's best to make it the night before. The flavors will blend together, the sauce will get thicker, and it's delicious on anything you serve it with.
That's all the time we have for today's show. I hope you enjoyed our adventure into the world of barbecue. Until next time, good eating and good health. What about, do you do anything to it? What's the preparation of the meat before you actually put it in the pit?
We have a dry rub that we put on it and let it marinate overnight.
Okay, so I was wondering if there was time to 24 hours with the rub.
Right.
Yeah, yes, is that across the same rub across the board with everything, or do you?
Well, we got a meat and rib rub that we put on the brisket and the ribs.
I see.
And everything besides the chicken. Chicken, we have a poultry and fish rub for
that. I see. And that's where the 11 herbs and spices come in. You cannot divulge.
Yeah.
Right. Okay.
You know, Kansas City is actually got a really rich barbecue tradition in the sense that we do a lot of different barbecue.
Yeah.
Okay, so
there's
North Carolina does a lot of great pork shoulder. We do pork shoulder, we do chicken, we do beef, we do sausage, we do brisket. We get everything dirty here, and it's all great.
It's good stuff.